Okay. When David asked me to do this session, or do the sessions, as I may have said to some of you before, what can I teach? I don't have any specialty. The history thing was a long time ago, and it's been done much better since. So what can I do? And David said, the one word I think I'm looking for from you is perspective. So he then suggested and assigned the 60s and 70s. Now, I'm different from most of you, maybe largely, in the fact that some of you came to Sacred Harp a year ago, 5, 10, 15, 20 years ago, whereas I go back 46 or 47 years, not as far as Eugene and maybe Geraldine, and about the same time maybe as David did, even though he's a good bit younger. He started earlier. But to the extent that you're interested in, and I know you are, what it was like in the 60s and 70s, in the 60s when I walked into it, that's what I'd like to gear this toward. And I would like to be a good reporter to tell you what it was like. Now, I'm not as astute musically as some of you are, so I will have missed that part of it and won't be able to answer your questions maybe along that line as well as possibly some others here will. But I'll do what I can. And I've just jumbled down a bunch of little notes of things to talk about. And just seeing how the session I had on Monday went, where it suddenly extended itself much longer than I thought, and we ended up sort of running out of time. I'm thinking that same kind of thing could happen today. So, but to the extent that you have questions along the way, by all means, ask them, because I've just written down, some notes to sort of remind me about things that I think you might be interested in, but much better to hear from you what, in fact, specifically you're interested in. Okay, a little about how I started. I think that maybe would be helpful to set the stage. I didn't grow up in a Sacred Harp family. It had been in my family. My maternal grandfather, who lived over around the Jones Chapel area between Cullman and Winston County, very close to that area now, was supposed to be a really good bass singer. My grandmother didn't sing Sacred Harp, but her older sister Martha sang treble. Oh, I wish I had known that or paid attention to that while she was alive, but I didn't. But along the way, my grandmother's husband, my grandfather, taught, some of you heard me say yesterday, taught new book, little book, gospel, Stamps Baxter singing schools for roughly 50 years and sang it. He loved that gospel music. And I did a little of that with him when I was in high school. But my grandmother, along the way, mentioned old harp singing, old Fasola singing, and shall hear the trumpet sound in that morning. That's all I got from her on that. And then to play on the golden harp, something like that. The golden harp and the morning trumpet. So it wasn't that I thought, wow, that's beautiful, I've got to have that, but it just stuck with me. And then in grade school, I was in maybe the second or third grade, and we had a visiting music teacher who comes around to all the classrooms and does, she was doing a session on folk music. Can you hear me well enough? Some difficulty?
Bouncy.
Okay. But I'm kind of bouncy too, so maybe the fix. as you'll see later. She did a series on folk music, and we did, the Erie Canal and all those folk songs that you all learned. And then in the little book that she had, there were three crows sat in a tree, and they were black as crows could be. The three crows was there. Now, fast forward, to die no more, to die no more, I'm going home, to die no more. Why did that little, simple little pentatonic melody stick with me those decades until I really wandered into this? Mary, are you taking minutes as someone? Great. I forget to do that every time to check to make sure somebody is. So it's almost as if there were predisposition to this kind of thing, that little melody and the set of words would sit there all those years waiting for me to discover this. Well, now here's the part I'm ashamed of or chagrined by. When I The old Fasola convention, courthouse convention, was going on in Cullman. The summer of my sophomore year or junior year, and so I took my grandparents to that singing because they wanted to go. Now, that magnificent courthouse building, why did they destroy it? Nobody now knows, except the few people can speculate that some builders in town wanted a project. You needed development. Unbelievable building. Inside it, there was a mezzanine or balcony all around the central part of it. And that's where we sat and observed this sort of strange thing happening down below. Incredibly, it didn't connect with me at all. I didn't hear minor music and be drawn to it as I later would. I have no explanation other than that I was just a typical teenager, maybe, and it didn't connect. Then I was away in school at Montevallo, Alabama College, and Mike Hinton, one of Tom Denson's grandsons, was in school with me there, and he heard some of us singing gospel music in the dorm one night, and he knew me, and he said, "I've got something you should hear," and he handed me the first two record albums that the Sacred Heart Publishing Company did, 101 and 102, and I was just dumbstruck. Could not believe it. Couldn't get enough of it. Played it over and over and over again. Keith Willard has a great little thing, did years ago in his newsletter, where he gives the various stages of a northern singer's infection, right? And about step six, step five, is spending all your hard-earned money on plane tickets to places like, Tallapoosa, Georgia, this kind of thing. But step six maybe was you want to share this with all of your friends and relatives. And step number seven was discover sad truth, most people idiots. And, so I, in every direction, I tried to pull people into this and found a few along the way who weren't interested, but by and large, it was interesting to them, but that was all. So I found out through the family, Ruth Denson Edwards became my mentor. And she had taught my father in school, and so the family made connections, and so I was able to go and meet her. And then that's how I got started. I attended the first Cullman County Convention that I went to after this conversion experience, maybe about 65, I can't remember now, I think that's right, in 65. I didn't lead, I just watched it. And then I waited another whole year for 66 to roll around. In the meantime, I'd practiced the songs and knew them. So when I got up to lead, what was my first song? Marilla's Lesson. And 282. And when I finished, I did it well. When I finished, startling, thunderous applause from that group. That someone who had never been before them, could do this so well. Well, pride goeth before the fall. And then I went to the little singing, was it the Harbison Chaffin Memorial at Prospect, New Prospect. And I led 144. And the singers there, as they used to do so much more than they do before all of you came along and held them to it, they would hiccup a beat for an unnaturally long rest. And so you had this long hole there with the whole note and then a half rest into the next, and so they hiccuped. And I was discombobulated with my leading and kind of embarrassed about the whole thing, but we got past it. Because Ruth Denson Edwards had taken me under her wing, people in that area and all around sort of assumed that I was one of the Densons. True, for years. And so I did nothing to disabuse them of that notion. Except when I sang and led, I guess it was obvious to many of them that this is an interloper. But what was the singing like in that time? It was all of a piece. the diversity in so many ways we have today. You just didn't have that. You walk in that room and just see that everybody there had been doing that same kind of thing all their lives. And something about the ethos of the singing and what they stood for connected with me. That 19th century hardship and so on. Let me tell you a little side story. Singing Jim Reed, Uncle Jim Reed, or even as he was called, Old Man Jim Reed, even though he died at the age of 47 in I think 1919. He is Cassie Franklin's, or Cassie, help me, Allen's great-great-grandfather. Grandfather to Harrison Creel and those that we have known. And just a word about, he was the singing master in that area and a great figure. And Marie Aldridge, this superb leader, Cassie's great aunt, I'll talk about a little bit later, once told a story about sitting on alto next to Whit Denson. Most of you know that Whit Denson sang this incredible, extraordinary alto, the high pitch. She, as a little girl, sat next to Whit Denson, and at the first break, he said, "Who are you?" And she said, "I am Marie Creel. I am Uncle Jim Reed's granddaughter." And he said, "Well, no wonder you can sing, or you can't." But this little detail about Jim Reed that's insightful to me. When he died, he left instructions that he be buried not at Reed's Gap over close to Blunt Springs, but at Little Vine, because he said he hated the thought of his bones having to be carried over all those rocks with horse-drawn or mule-drawn wagon. When those people sang, "It's a mighty rocky road," that metaphor had so much more force for them. We don't know what a rocky road is. To us, a rocky road, literally, the metaphor, it's a dirt road with gravel. You know, for them, there were outcroppings that made a journey like that really, really tough. Isn't that striking? But everything, I mean, think about the loss and deprivation that the people suffered in the 19th and early 20th century. The child mortality. You know, who didn't in a large family have one, two, or three of their siblings or their children die at an early age? Somehow, all of that took on a mythic dimension to me, and the people that I saw there were mythic figures for me. The Coleman County Convention, let's talk a minute about that. When I started singing, and then for some years after it, it was the biggest singing in all the country. We had that big, well, the Densons had taught there in nearby Winston County and in Coleman and in Walker. And the Coleman County singing was just the biggest thing going. There are so many tales about that. Aldo, let me back up and tell you this little story. Velton Chaffin, good singer from roughly this area, about 15 years ago at the Coleman singing, stood up and said, "I want to tell you a little story." And then he told about leaving the main hall where we were singing and walking out into the hallway, and he saw an old fellow there on the bench, and he said, "We're having a good singing today, aren't we?" And the old fellow said, "Yeah, but it's not like it used to be." And then he told him that when he was driving from Nashville to Birmingham on Highway 31, coming straight down in the 30s. And he said when he approached Coleman, there appeared to be, what Velton said, a traffic jam. Well, I later asked Velton about that. I said, "Well, now there couldn't have been that much, you know, there weren't many vehicle trucks and so on, wagons." He said, "Well, you know, I thought about that since." He said, "I think what he was saying was there were just mobs of people. And there was a policeman directing the traffic. And so when he pulled up close to it, he said, "What's going on here?" And the policeman said, "Oh, they're having a Fasola convention or Fasola singing at the courthouse." So he went to the courthouse. And he said, of course, you could hardly get in. There was a huge mob of people. The hallways were stood full of people, and of course it was literally impossible to get into the central core of that where the singers were. The windows were open, it was in July, hot weather, and that sound, the surge of the bass, those screaming notes from the treble floated down, to all the people around. One of my old singing buddies, Tap Bailey, who's 98 now, talks about going to that Coleman singing barefoot, riding over in a fella's truck in his bare feet and going to that singing and be amazed at that huge building and the big fans up there that turned. He said they had electricity then. They had their own power. And he said, we didn't have that, didn't know what that was like. So many people testified to that. And Aldo found a newspaper from, I think it was 1935, that said that they estimated the crowd at that year's convention at 5,000. One of the amazing things to me to see over the years was how quickly that fell off. There was a generation of singers there that just died out without followers. And that brings me to the second point. I was one of the few young people that I saw anywhere there, and one of the few from outside who came to that. Now, and David can testify that. Gene, that's the case. And someone asked me this morning, what did we think about how long Sacred Heart would last then? A great many of us wondered if it would last past the century. I've had a strong memory all along that when I did my book, and that is being passed around so you can see Ruth Denson Edwards' picture, hope so, just right where the paper is, it should be. I had a strong recollection that there was one Sunday in June in which there were 25 singing sessions going on in the South. Now, I recently looked back and to the book itself and only found maybe like 20 or something. And I think what happened is while the book was in preparation, there were those four or five that just fell off. And of course, the drop has been precipitous from that time. But it's amazing to think how much of that was going on. Now, one of the first singings I attended was from Montevallo when a friend of mine and my girlfriend, later fiance and wife, and his girlfriend at the time, he was conducting music at a country church in Chilton County, which was southwest of us just a bit. And so he knew that they were having a Sacred Heart singing and invited us to go along, and we did. Very small group. And one of the keys that I picked up there, and I've seen it so many times since, when the singing is weak, the number of songs they sing shrinks just down to very little. And when you see that, it seems there's very little hope. When I got there and they found out I was from Coleman, they said, all those folks up there can sing, come on in, And they thought I could really do it. So they asked me to leave. And I called for the golden harp, and they said, we don't do that. Striking, isn't it? And of course, that singing died away very quickly following that. One of the big changes that I saw, and it's not that much, is this, and several of us have mentioned this already, the dropping of the standard lesson from two songs to one. I want to talk a little bit about that. First of all, it wasn't doctrinaire that you had to select two songs that were companionable, that sort of matched, but that was the ideal. No rule about it ever, but that was sort of the practice, that you wanted to find something that was thematically resonant with the thing you just sung, or certainly in the same major or minor key. And so as a result, there was often a nod to this when people veered off from it. They would say, now I'm going to change music, or now I'm going to switch music. That's code for I'm now going from major to minor, going from minor to major. But it was kind of neat to have that, when people would think ahead of time and try, David is nodding, to find two things that sort of matched, that where the message was consonant with the thing you had just said. Well, in 1980, we kicked off Hugh McGraw and Bill Reynolds and the people at Samford University kicked off the first national Sacred Heart Convention in Birmingham, on the campus of Samford. And that first year, they had way too many leader. I mean, I think the attendance that time was, MRI was 1,400, over the three-day period. Maybe I'm doubling it. It may have been less than that. I think the first year it was just a huge number. Well, way too many accomplished leaders. And let me back up a minute. As most or many of you know, in the old convention days, only the best of the best led anyway. And they might lead for 30, 20, or 15 minutes at a time and got to choose whatever they wanted to sing and say whatever they wanted to say, assuming that it didn't violate the rules that we talked about in the etiquette session. So, well, then it settled down to largely at any convention or singing of any size to singing these two lessons up. Well, Hugh and the others, I guess, decided that we'd just let everybody sing one. That had happened in a few places earlier, after lunch on the second day of the singing, or maybe we'll just cut you down to one. But otherwise, that was a privilege jealously guarded. It was sacrosanct. And it was painful to me for this reason. In Coleman, at the Coleman County Convention, I saw the neatest thing. Myrtle Childress, a singer of some age at that point, my grandfather identified her as Joe Davis's daughter. So she was always Joe Davis's daughter to us from that point on. But Myrtle Childress got up and she would often lead 220 or 290, and this is what she would do. Something like this. I just thought it was the cutest thing, just the neatest thing, and I really wanted my parents to be able to see it. Well, by convention procedure at that time, you led on Saturday all of your visitors. On Sunday morning following that, the poor local folks who had not been able to sing were sacrificed and thrown in then. Get that out of the way, and then you go back and pick the best of the remaining leaders who had come from Georgia and Tennessee and Mississippi and South Alabama and so on. I desperately wanted my folks to see this amazing thing that Myrtle Childress did. I mean, I grew up, you might see somebody conducting music. You certainly never saw anything like this. I didn't know at the time that that wasn't roundly appreciated by most of the singers. It wasn't, and I'll tell you how in just a minute I realized that. So I went to the leaders of the convention, and back then I wasn't as forceful in trying to impose my will on others as I have become in my later age. So they were able to deflect this, and I said, could you please hold Myrtle Childress off until after lunch on Sunday? Because my parents were churchgoers, and they were not going to miss church on Sunday morning, so that they can see her. Well, you know, we'll get you a really good leader. We'll get you Elsie McCullough or somebody. Well, Elsie was a wonderful singer and a good leader, but this is what Elsie did when she led. She just stood right there and did this. That was no fun. But they didn't understand that I wanted to see this. So that thing of imposing the two meant that you could only get through half as many people on that first day. So gradually the Coleman Convention was then one of the first to adopt that. E.L. Patrick had been a school, an elementary school principal. And he and Buford McGraw, I'm sure it was E.L. though, instead of Buford that made the change, started mixing that in. And gradually, it's been adopted everywhere. If you go to a small singing, you might get to sing three songs in a row and then later on. But at a normal singing, everybody wants. And it's a great system, isn't it? A particular kick for me was getting to know and sing with, just be a singing buddy with, Marcus Cagle. Right in the front row of the tenor at the Coleman Convention, and just loved it. He had mellowed, and maybe I hadn't, but he had at that point, so he wasn't doing any of these extravagant, quirky things, you know, that we later heard about with, you know, his peaks of temper and so on. But the idea that I could be, and now telling you this, and 2011 with someone who wrote songs in 1908. It's just an amazing thing. I mean, he had sung with people who sang with B.F. White, and thus the generations are overlaid in that way. But it was an amazing thing, something I cherished. And then, of course, when I moved to Georgia, he was there, or when I visited over there, he was still there in the Villa Rica area. Are questions occurring to you as I'm going?
This county courthouse you're talking about, yes. Is
Coleman? Coleman, C-U-L-L-M-A-N. It's in Coleman.
And we had a really good one. The last few years we had wonderful things there. And the tornado got half of the roof of the courthouse and blew in the third floor, but we have the same on the second floor. So we still had
upper system.
And you like that? Do you have a reason? Was Mr. Cagle leaving at that time? Do you have a reason this time or what?
Not really. I don't. I mean, bent forward a little bit. Certainly, it was never any question that certainly that he knew what he was doing, but that he had the classes full attention and got what he wanted out of them. But not particularly. There's so many things looking back now that I wish I had known. And by the way, there's so many things I will think of before this day is over in the next few weeks that I should have. Why didn't I tell him that? That would have been really interesting. But anyway. Let me shift around a little bit then. Let's talk a little bit about the leaders at that time. First of all, the best leader I ever saw, the most dynamic and powerful singer, and there can be a leader, and there can be no question about this, was Hugh McGraw. In his prime, I mean, you had someone who not only knew every song backwards and forwards, but had this strong personality, absolutely no fear, no reluctance, and he had the ability to swiftly move and do things with his hands and even, with a foot. And you didn't get that from Sacred Heart singing previously. You got that from gospel quartets, but that was picked up along the way. But he could motivate and inspire a class the way nobody else could. Those sweeping movements and with the power of his voice would do amazing things. The most charismatic leader I ever saw was the black singer Dewey President Williams. I'll talk about him more later. Legendary figure, and maybe I can describe some of that later. But some of the men from that era whose singing caught my attention, my admiration. Well, for admiration, I just think Lonnie Rogers has been a beautiful leader. What he does with his hands and arms, you could do much worse than find that as back when he was leading as a model. Elmer Kitchens. Now, I know this was covered in a session that you did about the Kitchens later, or that Sandra Wilkinson did about Elmer Kitchens, because we talked about that ahead of time. But the question came up in Judy Caudill's leading class about how do you do 181 exit when you have those quick entrance points. Well, Elmer Kitchens saw that very colorfully. La 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 la. Would you like to see that again?
Yeah.
This is what he always did, and I'm talking about a preacher man. Yeah. All right. Even of some age, he did. That's just one little thing that I remember. Ed Snell, one of the Wiregrass singers, the black singers from South Alabama, remember? Wonderful. They stepped off every beat, typically. Many of them did. Now, Dewey didn't always do that. He could be free, but Ed Snell singing 460, one of his favorites. Back around the square and bringing the parts in. Wonderful to see. Jesse Dryden, Jesse Liner, just some names from the past. Barrett Ashley, marvelous leader who led without a book and clapped and did those things. Tom Harper, not a classical style at all, with this gravelly voice, incredibly coarse, gravelly voice. You'd think it wouldn't even qualify as tone. It was just all percussion, you know, wasn't it? And he would, as if he were slapping the air, you know, when he led, and hand behind his back. Is that right?
That's right.
Funny also, because when he was of advanced age, and maybe wouldn't be leading, somebody would say, "Uncle Tom, would you like a song?" 336. And it's a 411. He was ready. And the class would laugh because it was amazing how quickly he would throw out the letter he wanted. Love, Sacred Heart, singing dearly. But the women, the leaders of that time, let me just reel off some names. This was an amazing thing for me to see. The beautifully graceful leading. And let me mention the thing. As you know, a lot of what people were taught in that day was to sing without a book, to be free from it, so you could be free to do the things you needed to do, communicating with the class, and then to put your hand behind your back, you know, part of the time. Ludie Lambert, who was M.F. McWhorter's daughter, so sister to Millard McWhorter, and then when she told me about her older brother, who was already dead, and that M.F. McWhorter wrote 317, Jackson, I Am a Stranger Here, Beloved, brought the music to that. And Ludie told me one time, as she was talking about her older brother, and I put this in the book, although I didn't use her name, she said, "And oh, when he put that hand behind that back, is that just, that was just killer." Here are some names. Velma Richardson, Rosa Hughes, Maude Quinn, Kathleen Trawick, Mary Kitchens Gardner, Willa Dean Butler, Marie Aldridge and her daughter Lucy Hydorn, Kathleen Robinson, another one of the Reed Creoles, Merle Jones and Myra Palmer. You know, more recently, many of you got to see Amanda Denson lead, Tom Denson's granddaughter. And I said when I was talking to Jim, I apologize for this. Is it better for me still to try to steer through this?
Yeah, maybe you should stand
push
closer.
It further.
Push the whole thing up towards us. Can you?
Towards you? Well, the cord won't
stretch. Just the microphone. Just push the microphone.
Yeah.
I was talking with Jim Carnes once about how beautifully Amanda led, and I said, you know, isn't she outstanding? He said, well, it's not just that. That's her element. So, like, that's the medium in which she lives and floats, is that space, you know. Just a naturalness now, there. Now, it was built through and over all those years of riding in the back seat with Uncle Payne and Aunt Ruth and so on, where they're instructing her, you know, over their shoulders about what she's supposed to do and when. Beautiful things that they did, and I have a specific image of each of them, and I'm going to share a little bit of this with you. Now, to start with, I'm a man, and so I don't have and can't reproduce for you the grace that those ladies had. So anything I'm going to do now is going to be like a cartoon version of what they were doing. What I'm going to try to reproduce for you is what my eye saw, or what my eye remembers seeing. Okay, Maude Quinn and Kathleen Trawick were daughters of Uncle C. Doss, G.S. Seaburn Doss, from Stardust Community, just north of Birmingham. And when I first started singing, this is what I would see. We all began to die the moment, and hear my voice, the moment when our life began. We all began to die. Because I have these rounded shoes, that's my excuse for that. Beautiful thing that she was doing. Her sister Katie Trawick, really pretty woman, even into her 80s, and a beautiful leader. Willa Dean Butler from over in this western section could show you a tall, statuesque woman, strong and her movements, David, jump in here. Her movements were economical, strong, and she would turn and do that bass, tenor, never any doubt. And she knew exactly what she was wanting and knew how to do it. I guess as fluid a leader as I ever saw was Kathleen Robinson. Again, one of the Creole Reed. And she may be at Little Vine this time, but she's in really poor health. No longer able to lead, I'm sure. But this is a little bit of what people love to watch her lead. So they would wait and ask for her to lead. And she's doing a book like this. And very fluid style. And you know how when you imitate somebody doing something, you don't know how they're doing what they're doing until you imitate it. And you realize your subconscious has been taking all these little pictures. You know? And then you can, so I realize what Kathleen is doing. She's beating in two, but she's pulsing in four. Oh,
yeah. Right.
You know, she's staying in motion the whole time. It's a beautiful thing she's got going. I think I'm right on that. But if I had to pick one, Cheryl and Rick, Sonny won't be surprised to hear this, Merle Jones. Later in my life, in my Sacred Harp awareness, we were at the National, and I think I'd seen Merle Jones's name, but I didn't really keep up with Texas cookbook singers back then, shame on me. And I met her there. I was chairing the convention at the time, and when they called on her to lead, and she led, over the 3 days, she led 300, 142, and 430, I think. She loved minor and typically led it, whereas Myra Palmer, her sister, typically sang major. And when she started leading, I was sitting on, further down on the front row bench next to Sister Judy Hoff here. And when she started leading, I leaned into Judy and said, she went to Tom Denson's singing school. I didn't have to be told that. And at the break, I went up to her and I said, tell me something. Did you go to Tom? She said, yes, I did. She was so proud. In 1929, I went to Tom Denson's. You could just tell. Nobody else in that era sang the way people did who were instructed by him or by people who had been instructed by him. You just knew the Denson folks. There was a Tom Denson school. Cheryl, speak up now, or Sonny, tell me if there's anything more. Exactly.
He changed his style later, but they were, and they were just the most, and she still leads today. Yes. She's just as graceful as she ever was.
It's amazing. Yeah. Well, when I saw her, now think about this, she was 80 when I saw her, and she's getting up to lead, and I'm going to show you what she did to the best of my ability. She's leading Arbacucci. She's in high heels and a flowing dress.
Yes.
And she's leading that song, and all of a sudden she does this. Over her shoulder, she leans way back to bring in this entrance and goes. I never saw anything any prettier than that at a Sacred Heart Center. Just the most beautiful move, just so natural, and hers, you know. Just to lean over and bring those two parts. And now, we talked about bringing in the parts the last few days, and I'm less of an expert on this than any of the people who can tell you what to do, but we all know, don't we, that it's important to bring in the bass part when you're repeating a fugal thing. It's typically just the bass that do that. But otherwise, last night at our singing, you could have put a dummy in the middle of the square, and we could have all entered the parts. We don't have to have somebody bring in the parts. So why do that? And my feeling, my contention is that is a demonstration to the singers, to whatever audience is there, and to the person themselves of one's thorough engagement with the music. And when you turn to the part, it's not so much a solicitation. Now, you're telling them at some point if it's just the bass, but it's an acknowledgement of what they're about to do. And as a singer, you appreciate that and respond to it. Seasoned singers will tell you, if they're over there on their part doing special things, and the leader is up here just doing this, that's not bad, but there's no connection there. So much better when that person turns to you on that run or that high note. And you know, that's, I think, so you don't have to do it, no, but why do we like it? Because it's beautiful, and again, the second thing it does, I think, it helps to pry the singers from their books. You know, look at me, look at me, right? And that's one of the things that always has just amazed me, that new singers would come down to a singing and, you know, would be like this, you know. And I would say, you know, look at, watch her. There's a whole world out there beyond your book, if you'll just look at it, a world within Sacred Heart. Is this giving you what you...
Yes.
Oh my gosh, you're taking this word by word. Well, you could. Well, it is a demonstration to the singers and to the audience, if there's one, and to you yourself, of your engagement, your thorough, complete engagement with the music. And when we have somebody who knows that the bass is going to drop right there and that special sound, Judy did this as she's leading Wood Street right there, just before you closed your class, you turned over to Robert Stoddard and so on, and acknowledge what he's doing right there. Yeah, you know. No, we have till almost 12, David, is that right? Let me tell you now about the black singers from South Alabama. First of all, I went down to Cooper Book singing early on through Rosa Hughes. She had a friend, Arch Childs, who died from South Alabama shortly thereafter. But she told me that Arch could tell me about the black singings. And he told me about one, thankfully, at the Adams Street Baptist Church in Dothan, Alabama, right down on the Florida line. And so here I am, a young graduate student at Auburn, and I start out on this trek. And now think about that. This is the 1960s still, and here's this young white guy going down to join a whole congregation of black people who don't know him and don't know what he's about and might have reason to be suspicious of his motives. When I got down to the area, I was checking the directions, and I found myself in a heavily industrial area, and I saw two or three black men walking along the road, I don't remember now, and I stopped and asked for directions to the Adams Street Baptist Church. Well, they were a little reluctant, and then finally one of them says, you know, that's a black church. It's like, you know, that's not what you're looking for. He said, no, I am. So anyway, I get there. What a sound they had in those days, and how much it's fallen off now, so that we're just propping up this one little singing now left with just about a dozen of us. And without the singers from the surrounding area outside that tradition helping out, it would be over. Pardon? Well, they closed it, and then they started up a little fragment of it for the past 2 years that we've had. And Nathan Reese came down and taught, thankfully, a singing school to 8 or 6 people, Nathan, and then helped tremendously. He was the treble class for us for that singing.
Were they in contact with the black singers in Mississippi?
Have they?
Yeah.
Well, yeah. I mean, those connections have been made before, for sure. And I know that tradition has really sunk in Texas as well. But let me tell you what it was like. Well, first of all, a little bit about the social dynamics there. Generally welcoming, but the old minister there, I think his name was Humphreys, Bishop Humphreys, is of some age. And I have no doubt he had plenty of reasons to be suspicious. And I can't imagine what indignities you know, he had suffered over the years, but he was less than cordial. And when he, daylight savings time was a new phenomenon then. 1967, I think, is when that when this was. And so when he was about to call the class to lunch, he started off by saying, the white folks have got us on fast time. So I got to feel guilty about that, you know, about that too. But the one who really took to me was Dewey Williams. Dewey. Now, Dewey had that entrepreneurial spirit. And, you know, I think he probably thought I was a young man of some means to have driven down to their singing. So he wanted to make my acquaintance and talk to me. And that was the beginning of a long friendship and many, many opportunities to sing together. Now, I said earlier that he was the most charismatic leader I ever saw. 12 of us, I think, from North Alabama and Georgia were taken by Hugh McGraw to the Festival of American Folklife at the Smithsonian in 1970, where we performed every day for a week on the lawn in front of the, or off to the side of the Smithsonian, along with, I think 12 singers from the Wiregrass group, from the African American group singing in the Ozark area. And in our group were, and listen to this lineup, Hugh McGraw, Raymond Hamrick, Tony Smith, I'm just off the top of my head, Charlene Wallace, Elmer Kitchens, Palmer and Ira Godsey, the Adams sisters, Orly Fannin and Pernie Pelfrey. Who am I forgetting? Leaves me for Ruth Denson Edwards. Now, her voice at that point was not that crucial for what we were doing, but it was a great tribute, I think, to her, for her to be there. And there was a wonderful driving Miss Daisy moment at that singing, if you will. We alternated with the Wiregrass singers, rarely sang together because they were presented as two separate traditions, as in many ways at that point they were, certainly stylistically, and I'll talk a little bit about that if we have time. But it was so hot in July on the Mall. You know, those of you who've been there know it's brutal. And so after lunch, Miss Ruth was weary and sleepy, and so was Dewey Williams. And so Hugh opened his car, rolled down the windows, and opened the doors, and Miss Ruth lay down in the back seat of his car, and Dewey Williams lay down in the front. And it was just kind of a nice metaphor for the communication that we started. Because for most of those singers in our group, they had never met any of the Wiregrass singers before. I had that earlier experience, you know, with them, but it was a super thing. And then we all would go back together in the off rooms of the Smithsonian and sing in those chambers where it had great, you know, resonant acoustics and so on. And we sang their music and ours, and Dewey Williams would sing the special little gospel songs that he had. But I said he was a charismatic leader. When he led, he often, up there, had the microphone. And so the group behind him would be singing. He sang lead often, but bass was his real love. Bassist for me, he would say to Jacob Jackson off to the side. But then he would do his hand movements and ornament what he was hearing. Great ornamentation, woo, you know, all around. And the crowd just ate him up. They could not get enough of him. And he philosophized for them. He'd say, you know, if you don't know what love is, I haven't got enough time to tell you. No. Japheth Jackson. Just died at the age of what, 92, 93, died last June, I think. Japheth was the son of Judge Jackson, who wrote who compiled The Colored Sacred Harp in 1934, when he couldn't get his tunes in the mainstream book. So he and his family and friends put, I think it's about 70 pages in that small book. Now, what did I hear when I went to those singing? And my voice, you can tell I can't give you any kind of pitch at all, but 56, why don't you turn to 56 on the top. Okay, particularly in the second brace of that. So, and they very staccato beat, and enough space between and enough time so that you can step off. But so, la, fa, la, so, let me drop it. So, la, fa, la, so, fa, fa, so, fa, fa, so, fa. Lola, so fa, so fa, la fa, la so fa, fa, so fa, la so fa, so fa, la fa, la so fa, fa, so fa. Lots of vibrato in it. And then I heard sitting from Mrs. Green, sitting off to my left at some point, this, that I heard in many other ways as well. Now in the fullness of his love, oh, Lord, remember me. Oh, Lord, remember me. Oh, Lord, remember me. Oh, Lord.
Wow.
Amazing stuff. Yeah, yeah. But from Japheth Jackson, I heard something that really stirred my imagination. He told me at one point about hearing John W. Work's recordings from Fisk University in the 30s. Can you hear me okay? Of that large group of singers down there, what was a much greater singer, and I just can't imagine the sound that they put. And what he did was just this little fragment, fall, soul, soul, the fall, fall. Oh, the soul, the fall, oh, the also fall. And that's what he remembered from that. And that's as I remember it now. But with that kind of accent, with those big basses, voices, you know, you can just imagine what that sound must have been like. I would really love to hear that. The greatest class I ever saw, I saw a lot of marvelous ones, as you might imagine. The biggest class was the one that got together for the recording of the new tunes for the new 1991 edition on the stage of Samford University's Leslie Wright Fine Arts Center. Dan, was it, yep. Judy, was it 89?
90.
91.
90.
Okay, December of 90. Well,
I
mean, first of all, you had all these people who had composed the music, and then everybody who wanted to be a part of it, you know, so it was that was magnificent. But that doesn't stir my imagination as much as the bicentennial recording in 1976. Now, a word about that. The Sacred Heart Publishing Company albums had previously been done with each of the member of the 15 members of the board of directors being able to select four singers. So you would have a group of roughly 60 singers. And the parts pretty well just fell in. As you might imagine, when you get into a large number, they pretty well divide themselves. And so there was always a reluctance or a fear, it's one I certainly shared, about just opening it up to the world at large. There were a couple of singers, I won't mention their name right here, I might off to the side later on. There were a couple of singers whose voices were always off and who didn't know that. And there was a great fear that that would taint or ruin our singing. But Hugh went ahead with it. Hugh and Bill Reynolds set this up, and we were at a motel in Homewood, Alabama. Everybody was there. The Woodens had joined in the 70s. They had rejoined the mainstream. Hugh had gone up
72? 75. 70? 75, 6, 7,
okay.
4, when he taught the two singing
taught the singing schools. They had joined. And so I think I'm right in thinking that Four of the five brothers were there. Maybe Postel wasn't, but and then a bunch of the young lieutenants from that tribe. No notable singer that you thought of was not there. It was just an incredible class. Now, the recording itself, my own personal view about this is that in the attempt to make it sound good for an audience not familiar with it, we take moderate tempos, moderate pitch, and with all of those recordings, you could hear the singers and there was a lot of trouble getting them to extend a note and before somebody would or cough. It was just a tension in the air about it. It wasn't anything. Now, if you look at what we got with Cold Mountain, with 282, thrilling singing, you know, wonderful parts and beautifully sung, but it has the excitement of having done it. Those recordings didn't, and I think they sounded. But after we finished the songs, oh, and my highlight of the day was at some point, Hugh went off, maybe Bill Reynolds, to consult with the sound engineer, see how it was going, and Hugh says, Bill, why don't you lead them in a song while we're gone? And I get to stand up in front of this group and sing 103 Animation. One of my great memories. To have that kind of class do your will.
How old were you?
Well, let's see, that was in 76. I was born in 44. It's still a great memory. But, so after it was over, they shut the microphones off. And we just raced through about 30 songs. All this pent-up energy from everybody recognizing what they had around them. In your part and then across the way, a bass section to dream about. You know, all of these other parts. And so we did 434 and 300 and 35 and 159 and 318. And just people were shouting out numbers, just one after the other. Now, I have a little jackleg recorder. And Judy's heard this. That was over in the corner under my chair that I got that on. And it still captures the excitement of that, the thrilling, the high pitch and the soaring treble runs and everything. Marvelous stuff. A couple of singers I would want to mention. Jim Ayers, and Jim, Dan talked about him yesterday, but let me say for those who weren't there, it's worth saying, if there was a legendary singer other than Dewey Williams and Hugh McGraw that I was ever associated with, it would be Jim Ayers. Nobody had a bass voice like that. If we had him here last night, you could have cleared out the entire bass class and not suffered a bit. A voice of such astonishing power and depth and resonance, just amazing. I mean, he was a bass class to himself. Kenneth DeLong, he and I were talking about this one time about Jim Ayers, and he said, I remember the first time I ever heard him singing. He said, I was walking up to the church and I could hear his voice outside. You know, an amazing singer. And then, very tragically, he contracted Meniere's disease or some kind of inner ear problem and lost his ability to hear the pitch. So for two things, one, the singing came to sound to him like a racket, as he said. And the second thing was, he was impossible to sing with because he would carry the whole song off. You know, he was just, and had to live with that for the last years of his life. Remarkable and just a wonderful, wonderful man, a wonderful singing buddy. A Lloyd Redding, just a quick memory of Lloyd Redding. Some of you know about him. And Dan mentioned yesterday the little pickup sessions we would have. And at some point we were together with E.G. Aiken. Maybe Hugh was there as well. A small group of us at E.G.'s house or Lloyd's house singing. And when we finished 47 bottom or 47 top, I said, those are pretty tones. And Lloyd corrected me. Them beautiful tones, he said. I have a couple more things to talk about, but any questions you have that might steer me better.
I omitted yesterday to talk about the singers north of Atlanta. I don't know if you have any memories of like Boyd Cagle, Roy Garrison, and those.
I don't have specific memories of them, Dan, other than just, you know, general, just
or
being great.
Doris DeLong.
Doris DeLong, yes, yeah. And Horace DeLong, yeah. And I sang right. together for many years. And of course, Kenneth and then his sister, they were wonderful, wonderful people to sing with. Dan and I got to go in 71?
I think 71.
71, the Man and His World exposition in Montreal. It was a big thing, and we were performing in Buckminster Fuller, Bucky Fuller's geodesic dome. That was, and four of us got to go from our group, Hugh, Charlene, Dan, and I, one, two apart, and from South Alabama, Dewey Williams, Japheth Jackson, Dovey Reese, Japheth's sister, and Bernice Harvey, Dewey's daughter, the four parts as well. We alternated then with Roy Acuff and his band. And Hugh and Roy and Dewey just became the best buddies, just had the best time together. That was a thrilling thing. And Japheth Jackson, hearing Dan sing after having only been with us for a year, said, "Rookie of the Year." A group of us got to go back in 1976. And along the way, we would have pickup sessions with Gene Ritchie and Almeda Riddle and Bessie Jones of the Georgia Sea Island Singers and Alison McMorland from Scotland, and just great stuff in the dorm. They knew Sacred Harp, some of them did, and we would sing that or sing their ballads and so on, great stuff. And in 1976, I walked by and heard a group singing. There was a big crowd there under a big tent. Heard them singing, and I'd never heard of them, called the Watersons. And you know that's that, I know you know the saying, if you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail, or you tend to look at everything if it is a nail. So I'm thinking Sacred Harp, and you know this, how easily they could migrate to that. And so I went up and met them afterwards, and so we agreed to meet that evening. And so I brought my own book and gave them a book, and the five of us, the four of them and I, sat and we flipped through the book. They had heard two cuts from an old Folkways recording from the 20s, 318 and 294. And from that, they had seen Sacred Harp Singers, but they knew nothing else about it and had never seen it, had never sung it. And so we went through and did 47 Bottom and David's Lamentation and just had a wonderful time. And toward the end of that, they just broke my heart. They said, "Well, we love this music, but we could never perform it. We've made a commitment to perform only the music from our region, only the native music there." So imagine my surprise then 3 years later when I went up to do a workshop in Vermont for Tony Barrett, and was staying at his home, and he said, "I've got something I want you to hear." And he produced Sound, Your Instruments of Joy, and there were 47 Bottom and David's Lamentation and 206 Christian Hope that they had really branched out and found. So that was a real kick for me, as it was to meet this man from Switzerland, I think 4 years ago now, who's married a singer, Joanne Fuller
George,
was telling
George,
you about.
George Secret is the guy, he's married to Pam Regan, and they met at Camp Fasola.
Okay, well he...
George was inspired by...
was inspired by that, and so he came to the Coleman Convention, and Joanne is reminding me of this, and we're talking about how did you start singing. He said, "Well, I heard this recording by the Watersons," and everything. I said, "Well, let me tell you that I was involved in that." So that was a great memory. Meeting Andrew Lytle and Eudora Welty, famous Southern writers. Andrew Lytle had mentioned the Sacred Harp in the Agrarian Manifesto, "I'll Take My Stand." He has an essay titled "The Hind Tit," and he mentions the Sacred Harp there, and attending a big convention where a leader from every community is expected to come and represent and sing and so on. He's a poet and novelist as well, or was. A great figure and evidently a great gentleman. But as soon as the reading was over, I went to him and talked with him, and it found out that it was the Guntersville Courthouse singing that he had attended. And then especially Eudora Welty. She had mentioned Sacred Harp somewhere. I assume most of you are familiar with Eudora Welty. If you're not, you should be. A writer of wonderful grace and humor and so on. And she knew Art Stewart, for those of you who maybe who know Mississippi singers from that era, rural mail carrier who just carried the torch for Sacred Harp singing in that area. And she told me about going to the courthouse in Jackson, Mississippi, and seeing there a babe at the breast, as she put it, keeping time, taking his mother's milk, and it seemed to her waving time. So that's a wonderful little detail. I and many others always imagined and looked for a lost tribe of Sacred Harp singers. There had to be some, you know. When, if you look at something that was pervasive, let's just say water all over the area, and then it gradually begins to dry up, didn't it leave little pockets here that were disconnected from the others? And so when I would drive, particularly on a Saturday, not on a Sunday, because that would be church, but I would round a hill and see a big congregation of cars, and think it's a church and it's a Sacred Harp singing, and it would be a car graveyard, you know. There would be, so I was disappointed many, many times. But then I found out about the singers from the Calvary Convention from Central Alabama, who had been singing in isolation for just forever. And I can't remember the time of their first convention when we knew about it. It was like something like the 112th annual session. They've been singing for over 100 years. Now, remember what I said earlier about the little singing out in Chilton County. The same kind of thing there. The number of tunes they sang. Well, first of all, I arranged to meet the leader of the group, invited them to the national convention. They came. They got up and led 35. Or was it 277? Can't remember which. Anyway. And then I attended their annual convention for a number of years. Here's what I found. No parts. The alto was just the secretary and a couple of friends here. There might have been somebody sort of attempting to sing treble over there. No bass, all tenor. They would sing a song and then call a leader, and the leader would get up and call the same song. No notes been used. They would sing the same song from a different leader. And at some for a couple of years, I did a little kind of tactful little sermonette as best I could and said, you know, if you don't use it, you lose it. You know, we've got to get this back. So take advantage of me. I'm here and I can sing most of these songs. What would you like to hear? And I was surprised one time they called one of the songs we had just sung. But then, you know, we did the Hill of Zion and they said, ooh, that's a pretty thing. And then I asked about Sweet Rivers, and Faith of May Carlisle, just to my left, then said, my daddy used to sing that, please. And so, but it's funny how the skeleton was there without any of the flesh or tissue. They still had this convention of seven classes, if I can remember them, Murray Chapel, Enterprise, Poplar Springs, Seven Shape, that was one of them, Ozias, Whitehall, and then one more. And they would ask for a leader for each one of the classes. Long since there had been anybody there from Ozias. And I was asked at one point to sing for Whitehall or whatever. They were still following, you know, the formula. Yeah. They sold badges just as the singers did in the Wiregrass area. A badge for a dollar, a little ribbon, and took them. All of those things, it was still there. But and they sang without keeping time. They let the phrase die, just if you were singing around a campfire somewhere. No imposition of time at all. It was just an amazing thing to see. I think they finally given up. But that was my lost tribe experience outside the 60s and 70s. But it may be time to, I think it probably is time. Any questions?
So, people talk about the differences and what a heavy, heavy influence they have in the Sacred Harp of Run, legacy they left. A simple, several years ago, I came to Elaine McFarland was there, and she was a lady in the southern, in Lake Minnesota, cover of a girl.
Oh,
and like him, has completely. And she walked by and she said, oh, I had to dance sometimes with a little girl. She said, that's all right. She said, well, so she walked up. space that they gifted was just something that I don't think we had anymore. And I think it's the total love of good. You were wrong, but I think that's the same. But it's amazing that she's 80 some odd years old and plays tennis every day. So that was, you know, 50 some years she came up like that.
You got a kid's
other questions or comments, stories?
Tell about Ruth.
Well, I will tell that only because I'm not reading that as a part of what we're being here. But she taught for schools in Cullman County and City together for 46 years. I think maybe in Cullman City it was for 40 years. But she, you know, a single woman at that point. And when she went to apply for her job, the powers that be, you know how political that is, and you know how political churches are in small towns. Well, the Methodist folks really ruled the roost in Cullman. Baptists outnumbered them, but not where it counted. And so it was made clear to her when she was hired that she would be expected to teach Sunday school every Sunday morning. She didn't drive, and so when the family went off for 2 or 3 day vacations, you know, to singing conventions, you know, she was trapped and resented it until finally she retired and was able to be free to attend the singing she wanted to attend. I thought that's a poignant detail. It's why she missed so much of that. She could attend local singings on Saturday, of course, but that's just one little detail out of many out of her life. But such a remarkable person, as I hope I can communicate to you if you're here when we start back at 1 o'clock. Thank you.